Today we are going to do a tutorial on how to model flow between two concentric cylinders or circles. So the first thing you're going to want to do is load Workbench. We are using Workbench 16.2, which is the most current version available for the student version right now. So you wait for this to load. All right, now that it's fully loaded, you're going to get a screen like this. We're just going to full screen it. So what you want to do is we're going to be analyzing this in Fluent. So if you look under Analysis Systems, right here it says Fluent Flow Fluent. So you're just going to click and drag that over to the project schematic, and it's going to create it for you. It should be noted that you should not be using the Fluent down here under Component Systems. That'll only allow you to run Fluent. You should definitely just be running it from Analysis Systems because we're going to create the geometry in Workbench. So the first thing you do is to create a geometry is double click on geometry. All right, now that Design Modeler has loaded by double clicking on geometry, the first thing we want to do is create a sketch. So you can create a sketch on any of the planes. You can create it on the XY plane by clicking here and then clicking on the new sketch button right here. It's kind of like a blue rectangle. You can create it on the ZX plane by clicking on it and then also clicking new sketch, or the YZ plane by doing the same thing. So we're going to create it in the XY plane. So we click on that, click on new sketch. And you see that sketch one has been created under the XY plane. So the next thing we're going to do is we can click on sketching. And so what we want to do is we want to flow between two concentric cylinders. If you scroll down, or circles, if you scroll down, you can see circle. And so we want two circles, and we're just going to put them in arbitrary locations right now of arbitrary lengths and diameters. We'll fix that with the rest of the sketching tools. So if you look at these, modify would allow you to do some trimming, some splitting of these circles. We don't really want to do any of that. We are going to want to do some dimensions, but we will dimension it after we apply the constraints. So for the constraints, you want these to be concentric circles about the middle, about the origin. So if you click on concentric, you click on one of your circles, you click on the other one, and now your two circles that you created are concentric. And then if you click on your point, like you're now center of the concentric circles, and then the origin, you now have two concentric circles centered about the origin. Okay, so we want to apply some dimensions to this. So if you click on dimensions, you can adjust the radius. So we're just going to click here and click again. And as you can see, it's created a radius R1 down here. It's automatically 28.391, which is what we just set by creating it that large. We're also going to want to have a dimension for the inner circle. So we're going to just fix that right now. So click again, click, and you see R2 is 14.388 meters. So we want to create a much, much smaller circle than this. So if you just click on R1 and you make the outer radius 0.12 and hit enter, it got obviously much, much smaller. And then R2, which is the second one, let's make that 0.07 meters, hit enter. And as you can see, it's really small in there. If you want a better view of it, you can hit zoom to fit. You can zoom in other manners, and you can see that this is exactly what we want as our sketch. You can zoom these up here are these buttons on how to zoom, which this will just take you to the general picture. Because the radius is so far out, it kind of zooms out for you, but you can use this button right here to click, then click and drag and zoom in. All right, so now that our sketch is complete, we can hit generate. And we have a finished sketch. So we want a surface essentially between these two circles, because in Fluent, what you do is you mesh the fluid and then you model it. So what if you go to concept, surfaces from sketches, and essentially right here, we'll say the base objects, apply. Since it's already right here, you're not going to click on anything. What you just do is you can click on the first one, hit hold control, click on the second one, and then hit apply. At this point, we can just hit generate, and you're going to have a surface between the two sketches. You also see that one part, one body has been created under this tree. If you click on this plus sign, you can see the surface body. You can see down here that it has been changed to a solid. We want it to be a fluid, so if you click on it again, click and select fluid, now the surface in between the two concentric cylinders is a fluid. So that's all we really need right now, so we can exit out of it. Design modeler. It automatically links the design modeler geometry with your project, so you don't have to save it at separate points. But speaking of save it, since we have been making some progress, it's a good idea for you to save the entire project, which will save your geometry, your mesh, your setup, whatever you have completed up to the point when you save the project, it will save the entire thing. We only have the geometry done right now, but it's a good idea to save it. So we're going to go to File, Save As, and we're just going to put this right into my documents, and we'll call this Tutorial 1. Okay, so save. All right, so now that it's fully saved, we can go into the meshing software. So you double click on mesh. It should be noted that if you have updated the geometry after going into the meshing software, a dialog box will pop up at this point and ask you if you want to update your existing geometry in the meshing software. You're always going to really want to click yes on that, because if not, then your geometry changes won't be transferred to the meshing software. Alright, so now that the meshing software has loaded, we can see our geometry in the screen, and we're going to want to add some sizings on it in order to mesh it. So the first thing you're going to want to do is if you right-click on mesh and essentially insert a sizing. And so we want to add a edge sizing. So we're going to want to select an edge. Up here you can select a vertex, you can select an edge, select a face, select a body element. So we're going to be wanting to select an edge. As you can see right now, it still hasn't selected anything. It says geometry no selection. Anything yellow in your meshing software and or in design modeler previously essentially means that it needs this information. You have not selected it. So if we just click on the no selection, it'll now go into this mode where you can select it So what we're going to do is we're going to just select the outer ring. We're going to hit apply. And so we're going to want, instead of element sizes, which you could set, we're just going to set the number of divisions around the circle, and we're going to enter about 50. Soft behavior, we can click on soft, and we can actually scroll down and make it hard. The difference between hard and soft is that soft will essentially is more of a suggestion for the modeling software, where hard, it will do its best to follow those instructions. So always go make the behavior hard if that's definitely something you want. Additionally, the bias type, we're not going to change this. Essentially, this would enable you to make these essentially not evenly sized divisions. So what we're going to do is we can actually apply the same edge sizing to the inner circle. We could have done both of these in the same step, but for this case, it's worth the practice. If we were going to do it in the same step, when we were selecting the geometry, all we could have done was hold control and select the inner circle. But in this case, we're not going to do that. So we just right click on mesh, insert, sizing, geometry. It already is on edge selection, so we just click on our edge and we hit apply. We don't want element size. We want the number of divisions. The number of divisions we want to match the outer number of divisions so that it lines up well. So we have number of divisions is 50. The behavior we want is hard. All right. So so we've set the number of divisions around the edges. So what we want to do is, first of all, we want to make sure that this is a structured mesh. And second of all, we want to set the number of cells between each circle So what we can do to accomplish this is right click, hit insert, face meshing. Okay, so we're going to apply a face meshing to this face, and we can click apply. As you can see, it's going to do a mapped mesh, which means it's going to be structured, if possible, of quadrilaterals. And the internal number of divisions we're going to set essentially would be the number of radial cells between this circle and this circle. So we're going to set that as 40. And we're going to just hit enter, and that's okay. And so now at this point, we've applied all of the mesh characteristics that we want. So we can right click on this and we can hit generate mesh. All right. So this is the mesh that we have generated. If we zoom in on it, we can see that this is roughly what it looks like. If you actually click over here on this Z axis, it will actually view it from that direction. So if we click on it, this is what we're looking at right now. As you can see, it's not a perfect mesh, but it is pretty highly structured. It is highly structured, and there are a lot of divisions. So if we go back to our original view, this is all we want, so we're going to call it a good mesh and proceed to the next step. However, it should be noted that if you were going to do anything further, you actually could right-click on it, insert a refinement, and it will give you the opportunity to refine this if you hit apply, and you can adjust the factor of that. But we're not going to want to do that in this case because our mesh is fine. So if you actually right-click on it, you can actually delete this. So you're not going to want to add a refinement. Additionally, you can click on this and you can adjust a bunch of the sizing. So you can set the minimum size for the cells, the maximum size for the cells. These are things that are more in-depth. We don't need to do it in this case, but things that you should keep in mind if you're going to pursue this later on. So those are all your options for sizing. But what we want to do is we essentially want to name our inner and our outer wall so that we can access them more easily in Fluent. If we did not do this, it would default name these selections, and you would be able to figure out, it just would be much more difficult. So what we're going to do is we're going to create a name selection. So first of all, we want to select the outer edge. So in order to do that, we go up and we select our edge selector tool. We click on the outer edge, and we can right click and scroll all the way down, and it's create name selection. So we can name this something relevant, so we'll call this outer wall. It should be noted that the Fluent is smart enough to pick up that, say, if you call something a wall, the boundary conditions will be treated as a wall that you can go in and edit. You can change it. Let's say we wanted to make this an inlet and we called it a wall. We could change that in Fluent, but it's not going to default to that. So if we want something to be a wall and we know it now, we can call it a wall and it'll be much easier later on. We can also do the same thing if we wanted to call it an inlet, we could call it an outer inlet, and Fluent would default to inlet. So we call this an outer wall. We click on the inner circle, inner edge, right click, create a named selection, and we'll call this the inner wall, and click OK. At this point, we are completely done with meshing, so we can exit out of it. And as you can see, mine mesh has a yellow lightning bolt next to it. Yours may or may not. However, if your yellow lightning bolt is next to it, you won't be able to progress to the next step. So what you want to do to fix this is if you right click and you go down and you click update, it will essentially proceed and give you a green check mark, providing that your mesh is a fully complete mesh, which it was in the previous step. So that's exactly what we expect to happen here, and exactly what did happen. So in order to proceed to ANSYS Fluent, we can double click on setup. All right, now that the ANSYS Fluent launch, the Fluent launcher has launched, we essentially want to select some of our options. We're not going to do parallel computing. We're just going to use serial computing because that's what is most common for minor projects. Additionally, we want to always click double precision merely because you can end up into some rounding errors if you don't click on double precision. Dimensionally, it's 2D because we've only inputted a 2D geometry, so Fluent is smart enough to not let us click on 3D. And so then we can just hit OK to launch. Alright, so this is the screen that you will get when Fluent has launched. We're just going to full screen it so you guys don't get confused. Here's your mesh that we have previously meshed. You will see a bunch of options on the side here. If you're using a different version of ANSYS, some of these might be formatted differently. However, all of the options should be present when we eventually go through and do them. So here are some options on this page. You can scale it. You can check the quality. You can set whether or not it's a transient flow or a steady flow. We're not going to change any of these. So the next thing we're going to go is to models. So if you click on plus, this is where you can adjust any of the models. So we're not using any multi-phase. We're not using any energy. Viscous essentially means that we're using a laminar flow modeler. If we double click on that, you can see that we can change it to different turbulence models as well as keep it as laminar. So if you clicked on K omega, for instance, it would give you a bunch of turbulence information. You could set whether you want to do SST, some variables, but we're not going to do that right now. So we're just going to go back and click on laminar, and that's the model we're going to end up using. So nothing has changed so far. So we click OK, and we're not applying any radiation, heat exchanger. We're not applying any discrete phase or acoustics. So now we want to set the materials in order to change it, because if you click on this right here, you will see that the default material for the fluid is air. We don't want it to have air. That'll take a long time for our solution to converge. So if you double click on this, it'll launch this window, and you can change it by clicking on Fluent. I mean, you can then go to Fluent database, and you can scroll down and you can change it to any of these fluids. Or add any of these fluids. So what you want to do is, what we're going to do for this example is we're going to change it to glycerin. Glycerin is right here, so you can just click on that. Here are all the properties that Fluent assumes are associated with glycerin. The most important one for our convergence is that its viscosity is 0.8. So we're just going to copy that over and hit close, and as you can see, you can close out of this. As you can see over here, glycerin has been added to our list of materials. So then if we click on cell zone conditions and double click on surface body, we can then change this to from air to glycerin. And we could add frame motion or source terms as well as fixed values, but we're not going to do that. As you can tell, the rotation axis origin is 0, 0. We do not want to change that. We have it centered, two concentric circles centered around the origin already. So we can click OK. For our boundary conditions, you can click here. For the inner wall, we're going to add some rotation to it. So right now, you see the default is a stationary wall. We want to change that to a moving wall. And it's a rotation because we're having the circles rotate. We want to make it a rotational wall at a speed of, well, let's set the inner wall to, let's say, 100 RPM. So that correlates to roughly 10.472 radians per second. Again, this is arbitrary. And again, it's rotating about the origin. It's a no-slip wall. It should be noted that the speed follows the right-hand rule, so a positive speed is going to be, rotational speed is going to be in this direction, while a negative rotation speed is going to be clockwise or in this direction. So we can click OK. Now we can assign the similar boundary conditions to the outer wall. So we go to moving wall, rotational. The speed, let's make this negative 200 RPM, which corresponds to roughly negative 0.944, which again would then be the circle rotating in a clockwise manner. So we can click OK. We're not going to change the, it's not going to be, the mesh is not going to be changing, so we're not going to use a dynamic mesh. Additionally, we're not going to be changing any of the reference values. For the solution methods, this is where you can choose the solvers that you're using to solve your solution for your mesh, but we're going to keep all of these constant. But if you wanted to, you could go to pressure, change it from second order to a linear, so a first order solver for more stability, but less accuracy, obviously. And you can do the same thing for schemes. If you take a more advanced computational fluid dynamics course, you will know that these do different things, so you don't really need to worry about them. We're just going to keep all of these the same. So, on to the next part for solution controls. These are the under relaxation factors. We're going to keep these the same as well, but if you are having trouble with convergence, you can play around with these. Essentially, a lower under relaxation factor, like let's say this was 0.2, essentially means that the solution is going to take longer to converge, but it's going to be more stable. So that's what we can use in those instances. So if you click on monitors, if you double click on monitors, this screen will pop up and you can see the residuals. So this is how we're going to determine when the solution is fully converged. So if you double click on residuals again, you can see that the absolute criteria for continuity is that the residual has to be less than 1/1000th. And that's the same for the x velocity and the y velocity. This down here, the absolute convergence criterion, essentially means that each of these conditions has to be met for the system to be considered converged. Once all of these have been met, the solution will pop out as converged. So we're going to want to make these significantly smaller so our solution is more accurate, and we can do so by adding significantly more zeros. So we're going to add this, we're going to add zeros to these to make it significantly smaller so that our solution is much more accurate. So we're going to add 5 more zeros here. We're going to add them to each one. And click OK. All right, on to the solution initialization. If you click on this, and hybrid initialization works fine. Standard initialization has you initialize from a specific surface or point. So we're gonna just do hybrid initialization, and it's complete. So then you're gonna go to calculation activities. We're not gonna do anything from this screen, but this is where you could set the autosave. So you can autosave your solution every so many iterations. If you, for instance, were going to set this and let this go and then come back to it in several days, you don't want your computer to crash and lose all your data, or you don't want to see it go out of control after so many thousand iterations, and then you have to start back from the beginning. So this essentially will set up autosaves for every so often, whatever you specify. So we're going to run the calculation. The number of iterations is the number of time it runs. We're going to make this a fairly high number because essentially it will run this many iterations or until the convergence criteria that we specified in the residuals are met. So we want those residuals to be really, really small, and so we do not want them to the solution to say it's converged just because it stopped iterating. So in order to do that, we set this to a fairly high number, and we can click calculate. Okay, so now that you see here, you can see a bunch of residuals on the screen. The residuals are essentially decreasing as we increase our number of iterations. So we're going to let this run to convergence. All right, now that the calculation has converged, you'll see that the calculation complete has essentially dialog box has popped up. You can click OK. You'll see that all of our residuals have gone at or below 1 times 10 to the 8th. So the solution is converged. And so to analyze your results, you can use essentially this results section. So let's say you wanted to see what the vectors were. So let's check what the velocities are. So if you double click on vectors, you want to plot vectors of velocity by color and velocity magnitude. So you can just display this. Okay, so you can zoom in by using this button here and clicking and dragging. And that's approximately what we were expecting, the outer wall moving in a clockwise direction and the inner wall moving in a counterclockwise direction. So we can just close out of this. Again, we can do this for any solution, so we can see contours, double click on this, see contours of pressure if we wanted to, or whatever. So what we actually want to do though is we want to output this data to Excel so we can plot it. So what you can do is if you click on plots, you want to make an XY plot. You can also open it this way by clicking on that plus sign. So you want to click an XY plot. So clicking on this or clicking on this XY plot is not going to make a difference. So double click on XY plot. So you want to plot velocity. So the y-axis function you're going to change to is velocity. And you don't want to plot the velocity magnitude. You want to plot the tangential velocity. So what we're going to be doing is essentially plotting the tangential velocity across the radius right here. And as you can see, what I did to zoom out was click this button. It kind of fits to the window. So we want to plot the velocity, the tangential velocity. And we want to plot it across a line that goes from here to here. So essentially a radial line. So first though, we need to create that line. So because all we have for surfaces are the inner wall, the interior, and the outer wall. So if we click new surface, and we want to create a line. And so the number of points here only matters for the rake. Other than the line, it's going to give you a point for each cell. So we want to essentially have it start from here and go to here. So that's radial, only in the x direction. That way you know you're only moving in the radial direction. So this starts at 0.07 meters. And then the x1 position, which is out here, goes to 0.12 meters. And we're not moving at all in the zero direction. In the y direction. So we can zero those out. So essentially what we're doing is we're just moving radially across here. So we can recreate line 3 and close out. So as you can see, line 3 is right here, so we can click on that. And we're also going to want to write this data to a file. So we can click write to file. At this point, click write. And essentially it asks you to save it in a location. So what you can do is you can go to libraries, my documents. Let's just create a new folder called results. So click in results, click OK, and double click on results. And we're just going to save the file name. Let's call this the radial data. And click OK. So now that it's fully written, we can close out of this. And we can go to Excel. So you can launch whatever version of Excel you have. And open up a blank workbook, or actually we're going to open up our XY plot there. So you can go and double click, you can find it, the file that you saved it to. So we saved it to the results file, which is right here. And we want not all Excel files, we want all files, and we're going to input the radial data. And it's going to think it's corrupted, but we know that we just made this, so we just want to open it anyways. And it's a delimited file, so what we want to do, all of these defaults are set up correctly, so you can hit finish, but you can hit, in case that they're not defaults for you, we can hit next. We want the limiters to be tabs, and that's next. Just want everything general, and we can hit finish. Okay, so as you can see, here are all of our data. There are roughly 40, there are 40 data points, because we had 40 cells radial in the radial direction. So each one of these has an associated velocity with it. So you can add a plot of this and analyze it however you wish. So one final thing, of course, is we want to save this. So if you go to File, Save Project, it's going to save, we're just going to hit OK to use the current settings. It's going to save everything, including your mesh, including your data so that you've essentially solved for. Everything is going to be saved. If for some reason you only wanted to solve the Fluent case and the Fluent data and not save your Workbench entire project, you can go to File, Export, Case and Data, and through that you can essentially only export the case and data, so you can upload this directly to Fluent instead of going through Workbench. But we're not going to do that because we're just going to run everything through Workbench and their design modeler and meshing it all in one. And so this has already saved, by just saving the project in one of these, essentially in Fluent, we have saved the entire project. So we can just X out of everything because that is about it. So thank you very much for taking the time to be with me today. And if you have any questions, feel free to consult your professor and/or the internet. Thank you very much and have a great day.